The way I got into history, some of you have heard me tell this story before. My grandfather was a tank commander in the Second World War in the 6th Armored Division, and he at one point told me about showing up at Buchenwald about 3 or 4 days after it had been liberated, and he told me some extremely hair-raising things about that. And that was the thing that sort of got me interested in... I was a sophomore in college at the time, and that was what sort of got me interested in the topic generally. I knew a bit about it, and actually my mother had compelled me to learn German. My mother told my brother and I at a certain point when we were, I think I was in 7th grade, and he was three or four years younger, that she basically said, you're going to learn foreign languages. You can pick which ones, but you're going to learn them. And my brother, I think, picked Spanish, although ultimately he ended up doing Russian. But I picked German, and the reason was that they didn't have it at the junior high. So I figured this will be the way that I'll get out of this stupid thing. But no, my mom went and found this woman who, her husband was teaching at Whitman College, where my father taught, and she was a native speaker. So she set up this class for before school with me and 3 or 4 people who were sort of friends of mine. And you know, I was like, God, Mom, thanks. You found one of the small number of ways to make me less popular than I already was. But I always tell her now, I'm very grateful that she did it, because learning a foreign language is a really kind of a cool thing. It's useful to sort of get into the way that other people think. Now, as a result, I know a lot about German history. My specialty was actually East Germany, which is marginally less depressing, or depressing in a different way. But if you're going to do modern Germany as a sort of doctoral candidate, then part of what you get to do is a sort of deep dive through the history of and the literature on the history of National Socialism. So this is how I came to know a lot about this topic, and we kind of joke about it in the reference office sometimes. I'm a reference librarian here. That people are always interested in Nazi stuff, and they are. Like these talks that I give, and don't get me wrong, I'm very grateful for you guys coming out, and I hope very much that I can provide something that's sort of interesting and enriching for you. But it's, you know, the biggest talks that I do are the Nazi talks. But that's makes a certain amount of sense too, because National Socialism is, in a lot of respects, the most compelling event of the 20th century, and it's sometimes a little hard to understand why this is. I mean, it involved a lot of mass killing, and that's the thing that gets people's attention. But there were lots of incidences of mass killing in the 20th century, and a lot in which a lot more people were killed than this. I mean, Stalin killed a lot more people than Hitler. Mao killed far more people than Stalin did, or was responsible for the death of. I mean, they didn't personally do it. So why is Germany so fascinating? And I think one of the reasons has to do with our, not to put too fine a point on this, but kind of cultural chauvinism, because the Germans seem like us in a way that the Russians or the Chinese kind of don't. And this is partly just because of our kind of in-group way of thinking. The Germans seem more proximate to us. I mean, like, you know, name a Chinese composer. you probably can't. And it's not because there aren't many brilliant composers of music in China. Now, of course, we can all like Rachmaninoff or Tchaikovsky, but my point is that Germans, I mean, you can name all these great Germans, that, you know, Beethoven and Kant and Schelling and Max Weber and all these brilliant thinkers who have contributed a lot to the sort of way we think about ourselves in the West. And so after the war, this was a big issue, a big question that people were asking. How do you get from the people who brought you Goethe, the people who, you know, the people who brought you Heinrich Heine to Auschwitz? And you know, Auschwitz is not just horrible because it's mass killing. There's lots of that, and not to say that mass killing isn't horrible, but Auschwitz is a whole other level of horrible, and it's because it's mass killing combined with Taylorism. You know what I'm, does everyone here know what I mean by Taylorism? Like factory production, Taylor sort of was the guy who invented the time management or the time movement study. So, you know, you do things most efficiently. And that's what Auschwitz was in a sort of horrible, horrible way. It was the combination of mass killing with a sort of scientifically guided procedure or an efficiency-oriented way of doing things. And I mean, it's just, that's sort of one among several things I think that's interesting about it, or why it's fascinating, horribly fascinating to us. So I'll say one small other thing before I get started here. I just tried to sort of pick some sort of signal images, and you can see Hitler here taking the march by from a bunch of SS troopers, and this is Berlin at the end of the war. That's the Reichstag right there. This is the 1936 party rally, I think, in Nuremberg. This is Plötzensee prison, which was in Berlin, isn't there anymore. And that's where a lot of the regime opponents were executed. The mode of execution in Germany before the war was beheading. And in Saxony, it was done with a guillotine. But in the rest of Germany, it was meant to be done with an axe. And so when they decided that they were going to do more beheadings, they actually built another guillotine and brought it up to Plötzensee. Now, Plötzensee was pretty much completely destroyed, or a lot of it was destroyed with most of the rest of Berlin during the war. And the only thing that remains there now, it's weird, I went to go see it when I was in Berlin, and the only thing that's there is the sort of execution chamber, which sort of stood apart. And you can see the guillotine was destroyed too, but there's a sort of beam across the top with a series of hooks that they used to, like, they would tie the rope to the hook and then they would put the person there and hang them. And it's a weird thing because it's right in the middle of an industrial estate. You have to sort of walk down this nondescript road with high concrete walls, like with factories around, and then you go in this thing and here's the Plötzensee Memorial. It's very weird. Anyway, Martin Niemöller is an interesting guy, and I thought I would start with him. We're going to do this thematically. There's so much information that, like, we can't do this sort of like in a linear time sort of thing. So I'm going to try and like give you what I think are the most important bits of information about what Nazism was like in power. Niemöller was a Protestant pastor. He was an ardent German nationalist. And he thought in the beginning that Hitler wasn't such a bad guy. He also was an anti-Semite in that way, in that sort of low-grade way, which is not to excuse it. He wasn't one of these sort of flaming Nazi street fighter anti-Semites, but he didn't think very much of Jews. He later reevaluated that view. It happened to be while he was in a concentration camp, which is the sort of experience which would give you pause and maybe make you think about the error of your ways up to this point. He thought the regime was pretty okay until the mid-1930s when the Nazis had this very bizarre relationship to Christianity. I think I've mentioned this in some of the previous talks. Some people were okay with it, some other people. The Nazis had a sort of, the difficulty about talking about Nazi ideology is there wasn't one. There were a lot of overlapping ones that had a lot of commonalities. That anti-Semitism was one main thing. Very ardent nationalism, cultural chauvinism was another. But there were some very hardcore sort of pagan types. We'll get to this in a little bit. So the Nazis thought that what they would do, and it wasn't really like they were threatened by the church. I mean, the Pope signed off on a concordat with Hitler, essentially saying, I'm not going to worry about politics, so if you leave the Catholic Church alone. The Nazis, though, of course, you know, what's the number one problem with Christianity if you're an anti-Semite?
Jesus was a Jew.
Yes, exactly. And now, here's the difference too, and we'll get a little more about this a little later, the difference between Nazi anti-Semitism and sort of normal, what you might say normal, European cultural anti-Semitism. In most other places, if you were a Jew and you converted to Christianity, then it was okay. But Nazi anti-Semitism was biological anti-Semitism. And their view essentially was that Jews were Jews by blood. This is a very dangerous idea. And it leads to you shooting lots of children, which is what they did. Not to put too fine a point on it. So they had to come up with some new version of Christianity, right? If they were, if it's going to be okay that Germans are Christians, let's just prove that Jesus wasn't actually a Jew. And they created a whole research institute devoted to this whacked out idea. And I mean, they were really serious about it. There's a book by a woman named Susanna Heschel called The Aryan Jesus. We can't get it here because it's sort of a scholarly book, but you can get it through Ohio Link, and I really recommend it, because it'll just make your jaw drop when you see the kind of gymnastics they went through to try and prove that Jesus wasn't in fact a Jew. Whatever else Jesus of Nazareth was, he was a Jew. Let's just establish that fact. So anyway, the Nazis also just didn't like sources of power outside of themselves. So they became more and more aggressive about the Christian churches. And as a result, a certain proportion of the Protestant pastors started a separate church from the sort of state-run Lutheran church, and it was called the Bekennende Kirche, or the Confessing Church. And they were real, a number of the Bekennende Kirche people ended up getting executed because they really, a lot of them, were willing to stand up to National Socialism. But it took a lot of guts to stand up to National Socialism because they really would shoot you. They were really pretty serious about they were pretty unflinching about not taking any guff from you, no matter who you were. And there's some other interesting stories we'll talk about that. But so Niemöller was eventually, because he was involved in the Bekennende Kirche and because he expressed opposition to the regime, was arrested by the Gestapo and ended up getting sent to Sachsenhausen, and then I think Dachau. He ended up in Dachau anyway. Sachsenhausen would have been the obvious place, but. And after the war, he sort of. There's a lot of argument about how he composed this poem or this, about what the origin of this is, but it's something that's worth remembering as we go through this. First, they came for the communists. I misprinted there, but communists. And I did not speak out because I was not a communist. Lots of Germans didn't. They thought, well, the communists want to destroy Germany anyway, want to sell us out to the Soviet Union, so Nazis want to lock them up, okay. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Once again, and this guest starts to get into people, and not just Germans, have a sort of view that if the cops are taking you away, that you probably did something to deserve it. And a lot of people got arrested in Germany, and people just stood by and thought to themselves, well, you know, I hope nothing bad happens to that person, but probably if the police are after them, I mean, the police aren't bad people, necessarily, although it turned out that in many cases they were, they probably did something to deserve it. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. And once again, the Nazis were very cagey in the way that they did this. So they allowed you to sort of believe that really bad things were not happening if you didn't want to look at it. This is something that it's worth remembering, and we'll get back into this a little bit later. That there are a lot of things that people sort of said afterward. One of them is, well, we just didn't know. That's just not true. I mean, the Nazis put the killing centers, there's a reason why they were in Poland, all the major killing centers, Belzec, Sobibor, Treblinka, Majdanek, Auschwitz, Chelmno. They were all in Poland, and there was a reason why that was. All the gassing, with a very small number of exceptions, happened in Poland. And the reason was, so if you didn't, it was sort of a plausible deniability thing, right? If you didn't want to look at it, you didn't have to. And a lot of people just thought to themselves, you know, I'm just going to keep my head down here, and maybe some bad things are happening, but maybe they really are just being sent to the East to work. Well, I don't know that that's not the case. So, but if you wanted to know, you could. Soldiers were sending back pictures all the time. By the way, there's a lot of grim pictures I could show you about this, which I'm not going to. I just don't think that that does any good. I think it's also disrespectful to the victims. You can find them if you want to. I think the Nazis are horrible enough just on the basis of what we can say about them without just looking at pictures that dehumanize. But soldiers, and this is a fact about soldiers in the modern era that's pretty universal. One way that they have of coping with horrible things is taking pictures of them. Michael Herr, the Vietnam War correspondent, said that on dozens of occasions he would go visit ex-soldiers and the first thing they'd do is pull out a box of pictures that they had. And some of them were very, very gruesome. And it was just part of their way of coping. So soldiers, a lot of times, you weren't allowed to take pictures at these actions, but soldiers did. And so we have a very clear idea of exactly what was involved. But once again, they put it somewhere else. So if you didn't want to know, you could pretend that it wasn't happening. Anyway, then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak for me. And that's the sort of situation that a lot of Germans found themselves in. And let's be clear, too, about Hitler. Hitler was fantastically popular until about 1943. Another thing you hear is, oh, God, by the time we found out, it was too late. They'd taken our guns away. This is not true. I mean, Hitler was really popular until 43, when the shortages really started to bite, and when Stalingrad was happening, and when it became clear that there was a very good chance that Germany was going to lose. And then people started, oh yeah, Hitler, he's terrible, all those people. Yeah. But, you know, these people are just like, you know, by the time we found out, people had every reason to know what was going on. 1934, 35, 36, the idea that all of a sudden 1943 rolled around and that was when the scales fell from their eyes that's just sort of one of those kind of retrospective justifications people like to offer themselves for having done something reprehensible earlier on. In 1932, the German government was in deep crisis, partly because Chancellor Brüning had instigated let to arise a deflationary spiral. Once again, for those of you who are worried about inflation, deflation is very much worse. And deflation was the thing that brought Hitler to power in the immediate term, not inflation. Inflation happened in 1922 and 1923. And this is not to say that the hyperinflation that happened was not important in terms of making people feel like the Republican order was somehow broken, but it was the deflation in 1930, 31, 32 that really was the immediate precursor to Hitler. Brüning had a lot of reasons for doing it. One reason was he thought that it would destroy the trade union movement, which he was really opposed to. 1932, they have an election in which the Nazis win the most votes, but this is a proportional representation system, so they only get 37.5% of the seats in the Reichstag, which makes them the largest party, but not a majority, or not an absolute majority. So Hindenburg, who's the Reich president, the former general from the First World War, didn't like Hitler at all. Viewed him as not German because he was Austrian, also because he had been a corporal. Hindenburg really didn't have much time for people below NCO level. So they form a government with Franz von Papen, who's a Catholic politician. But it's a government that has an admixture of Nazis in it. They form a government with Franz von Papen, which doesn't have Nazis in it. It's not till the next time around. And the reason was that Hitler didn't want to get into a coalition government. Because he didn't want to be, he didn't want to have Nazis working to preserve the Weimar Republic, which he thought was a bad idea to begin with. So there's a subsequent election, because once again the state is completely gridlocked. I mean, they have to, they're trying to sort of run the state on the basis of Article 48 of the Reich Constitution, of the Weimar Constitution, which basically says that if the state isn't working, the government, the chancellor can rule by decree. At this point, there's mass violence going on in the streets. Basically, everybody has a sort of, all the major political parties have a fighting wing. The Nazis have the Sturmabteilung and the brown shirts. The communists, who are the second largest party at this point, have the red front fighters. The social democrats have the Reichsbanner. And these people are duking it out in the streets and occasionally shooting each other. In a sort of Wild West type atmosphere. And as a matter of fact, the gun law that they did have, that they instituted in 1928, was as a response to people in these like fighting groups shooting each other in the streets. So they were trying to get a lid on that. But finally, it becomes clear that nothing else is working. So a sort of coterie of big business people and conservative politicians get together and they sort of think, well, Hitler says a lot of crazy things, but he's probably an okay guy underneath. He definitely says a lot of nice things about Germany. So if we get him in office, right, that'll just knock the rough edges off him. There's a German proverb, any of you who grew up in the German-speaking world may remember that it translates roughly, soup is cooked hotter than it's eaten. And that's what they thought about Hitler and his rhetoric, right? That he's he says all these kind of extreme things, but he doesn't really mean that. We have to look into Hitler's heart and find his love of Germany, and if we get him in power, then like the sort of importance of the office or whatever it is, you know, we'll be able to sort of channel him into what we want him to be. This was one of the most, there were two catastrophic miscalculations that brought Hitler to power, and this was one of them. The other one was the communists. The communists had this idea. So in the theory of communism in these days, the idea was that Nazism was the kind of last gasp of capitalism. Capitalism is riven by contradictions, and that it gets to a certain point that the only way that it can be maintained, the only way that the system can hold itself together, is through just naked violence. And that's what Nazism is. And so we should help the Nazis, right? Because as soon as they have this kind of stage theory of how things are going to happen, we'll help the Nazis, we'll vote with them in the Reichstag, on certain things anyway, and then they'll take power, and capitalism will collapse, and, you know, the communist utopia will happen afterwards. This was a catastrophically stupid idea, for which, sadly enough, a lot of communists paid with their lives. I mean, really, like the, as we'll see in a minute here. January 1933, Hindenburg, who's kind of ailing by this point, finally relents and appoints Hitler chancellor of a government that's a kind of coalition between the Nazi Party and the Deutsche Nationale Volkspartei, which is another, like, the other extremely conservative party that was mostly big businessmen and people like that. Papen was made the vice chancellor, and he basically told Hitler when the whole thing went down, we're going to sort of keep you in line here, which was didn't work out all that well. On the 27th of February, about a month later, a Dutch communist named Martinus van der Lubbe broke into the Reichstag, the German House of Parliament, and burned it to the ground. He did it, he said later, to protest the violence against the German working class that the Nazis were undertaking. He was arrested. Later they guillotined him. But Hitler used this as a sort of moment to pass a series of laws essentially getting rid of most civil rights for people. And what's today, the 24th of March? 23rd. Yes, the 23rd. Tomorrow is the anniversary of the Enabling Act, which was passed roughly a month later, and which basically legalized all the other political parties. But Hitler still didn't want to sort of go fully into his program, because Hindenburg was still alive, and Hindenburg carried a lot of sort of moral weight. But Hindenburg was ailing badly. He had retired to his estate, and it was pretty clear that he wasn't long for this world. And then, toward the end of summer, in the next year, he died. There's this kind of interregnum where people are sort of trying to figure out what's going to go on. But one thing that happens is Hitler and his party start really moving against the other political parties, and first of all, the communists. And they did this for a reason. Because, as I was mentioning before, people distrust people who weren't communists, distrusted the communists. The communists, God, had a whole range of very dumb ideas. One of them, another one, they were kind of being, the difference between communists and social democrats, for those who don't know, is that the communists basically take their orders from the Communist International headquartered in Moscow. And the socialists, the social democrats were nominally Marxist, nominally revolutionary, but hadn't really been for a long time. Friedrich Ebert, the Reich president, the first president of the Weimar Republic who was a social democrat, said he hated revolution like sin. For the communists, the socialists were basically traitors to the working class. And they were told by the leadership in Moscow that the socialists were in fact social fascists and were worse than the Nazis. And so throughout the sort of collapse period of the Weimar Republic, the social democrats, the communists absolutely refused to work with the social democrats and actually fought them in the streets. But what we see in this period is mass arrests of communists, of socialists, of other political activists from various parties, even conservatives. The Nazis really were not cool with extra-party conservatives or conservatives from other with other leanings besides them. They open a series of camps to put them in. This is the origins of the concentration camp system. So they open Dachau, which is right outside of Munich, and Oranienburg, which is sort of near Berlin. And also they had a big one that was right across the street from Tempelhof Airport that was called the Olympia. I should have looked it up. There's a plaque there, which I used to live near Tempelhof, which is not really an airport anymore. But as I would go running, I would see this sign. It's on the side of like an outdoor disco, which I think is probably a better use of the place. Essentially, the passage of the Enabling Act makes the Reichstag superfluous. And Hitler basically undertakes to rule by decree and declares that the Nazi Party is the only legitimate political party. It's more the case in other countries, like for instance, if you live in Great Britain or you live in Germany, that the newspapers have a very pronounced political slant. As people complain that the New York Times is super liberal or the Washington Post. I don't quite see it, but whatever. But if you live in England, you know the Guardian is left liberal, the Independent is closer to the center, the London Times is center right, the Telegraph is very right. If you live in Germany, you know, I mean, I won't name the newspapers because you mostly don't know them probably, but so newspapers tend to have a very pronounced political slant. In these days, the Frankfurter Zeitung was the big Frankfurt newspaper was the major liberal newspaper. And the Nazis basically start censoring the newspapers quite heavily. Because they don't want the papers sort of printing material for what they like to call atrocity stories in the foreign press. Atrocity stories are essentially any story that tells you about people getting beaten down in the streets or what have you. There's a large expansion of an organization called the Schutzstaffel, or the SS. The Schutzstaffel started out as Hitler's personal defense unit. And it grew to be one of the most fascinating criminal organizations in the history of the Western world. I mean, really, there's a massive literature on it. There's a really good book that we have here by a fellow named Hirne that's called The Order of the Death's Head. It's really long, but I think it's worth reading. The SS eventually turns into a kind of shadow state. For any of you who are familiar with the way things work in Iran, I mean, there's a sort of comparison we made here to the Revolutionary Guards. Like, the Schutzstaffel had its own industries, had its own justice system, and it had its own security service. In fact, it had two. The Gestapo, the Geheime Staatspolizei, which is the secret state police, who were started in Berlin, in sort of the northern part of the country, and then the Sicherheitsdienst, the security service, which was started in the southern part. And they started out sort of in competition with each other, as is so often the case with the structure of Nazi government. We'll talk about this more sort of further on, but the way Nazism worked was not like, I'm going to create, you know, institution A, B, C, and D, and each one will have its separate function. Nazism was like, I'll create institution A, B, C, and D, and then I'm going to give out a sort of series of tasks that I kind of want done, and we'll kind of have a Hobbesian struggle amongst them to see who's going to do what. So they eventually decided that they wanted to be the leadership of both, decided that they would work together. But the problem that they had was that Hermann Göring, who was a sort of close protege of Hitler, had been made the head of the Prussian state. Prussia was a weird anomaly in Germany because it was about two-thirds of the entire country. And so they had to sort of outmaneuver Göring to be made the sort of like main secret police people. And this is another part of the weird kind of internal politics of... Göring is a fascinating guy. Does anyone know like what he did in the First World War?
He's a pilot.
Yeah, he was an air ace. Yeah, he fought with the Richthofen's Flying Circus. And he was a real brute. I mean, he was a very bad person. Later on, he became extremely fat and addicted to morphine, but he was still a bad person. I mean, so a conflict arises within the Nazi Party because it has a number of sort of competing things going on within it. It had its fighting wing, the Sturmabteilungen, and they were run by a fellow named Ernst Röhm, who was a street fighting goon. And he had this very like revolutionary idea. So after Nazism takes power, there's kind of problem in the Sturmabteilung, because what are they going to do? They can't be going around busting up communist meetings anymore because there aren't any. They can't be going around, you know, engaging in saloon brawls because that looks bad for the regime. So they're kind of looking around for something to do, and this makes the rest of the Nazi Party kind of uncomfortable. Röhm at one point says, like, we need the Nazi Revolution to continue. It needs to be a continuing thing. And Hitler's like, no, the Nazi Revolution happened. It's happened now, so we don't need any of this, like, continuing revolutionary stuff. Also, there was a kind of a left wing to the Nazi Party. People sometimes say, I know I've griped about this before, for those of you who've sat through this before, The Nazis were not socialists in any serious way. They appended socialism to their name because they wanted to get more workers to join, but they weren't like socialists. As a matter of fact, Hitler said in private, and he also said to the major industrialists in the country, we respect private property because if you don't, it destroys individual initiative. They only actually really nationalized one company, the Junkers airplane manufacturing. Now, they confiscated some other companies and cartelized them, made them so in the coal industry they basically unified all of the coal companies. But they kept it in private hands. It wasn't a state-owned thing. And just to be clear, it's not like the bankers were running out of Nazi Germany. They did quite nicely, and the industrialists did too, until the Allies bombed everything to the ground. But that's another story. But there's a sort of a left wing of the Nazi Party that was run, that was particularly associated with two brothers, Gregor and Otto Strasser. Strasser had these ideas about like real nationalist socialism where there was like a community, and you know, he didn't want like communism, like everybody's on the same level, but he wanted a sort of like, you have to understand too that sometimes the Nazis would say sort of anti-capitalist things. But that kind of, the kind of capitalism they were talking about is finance capitalism, which they associated with Jews. Strangely enough, because finance capitalism in Germany was run by like non-Jewish people in just as great a proportion. I mean, it's not like the Jews were probably like slightly overrepresented among like financiers, but not grossly so. And who cares if they were? But the idea that like, so sometimes the Nazis would say these sort of like anti-capitalist things, but what they meant was what we want is like productive industry. We don't want money like in this sort of crazy dance of the millions where, you know, it's money produces money and whatever. That's a Jewish thing by their crackpot lights. But the Strasser brothers and a certain number of people within the party were like very into this idea. And Hitler really didn't like it. And so he decided that he was just going to get rid of them. And so in 1934, they have this evening where all of a sudden most of the upper SA leadership are pulled out and thrown in jail and shot. Room was pulled out of bed, sent to jail. The jailers came in and handed him a pistol and said, you have 10 minutes to shoot yourself. They came back 10 minutes later and he hadn't done it, so they just shot him. They got rid of a lot of the upper SS leaders. Or SA leaders, excuse me, not SS leaders. But they also got rid of a lot of other people. They got rid of Ernst Röhm. They got rid of Gregor Strasser. They didn't get rid of Otto because Otto had like left the country a while. He'd been sort of kicked out of the party for his weird socialist leanings. They killed Kurt von Schleicher and his wife just because they happened to find them together. Kurt von Schleicher had been, he was a general, and he had been a Reich's chancellor. He was very conservative, but he had sort of tried to crack down on the Nazis, and they had a long memory about that sort of thing. They killed Gustav Ritter von Kahr. Those of you who were at the last talk may remember that von Kahr was the ran Bavaria in the immediate post-war era. He was highly conservative, but had cracked down on the Nazis, and once again, the Nazis don't forget and they don't forgive. They killed Herbert von Bose, who was a Catholic politician who had basically written speeches for Papen. They killed Anton von Hoberg and Buchwald. He was the only active SS member to actually be killed, and he was just killed because the local SS, he was in a sort of conflict with one of the other SS people in his area, and the guy just thought, take this opportunity to get a few other things sorted out while we're doing some shootings. They wanted to shoot Papen. Papen happened to be out of the country when the whole thing went down, so good luck for him. But that was basically the Nazis' way of saying to everybody, it was their way of saying to the SA and their way of saying to everyone else in Germany, revolution's over. the state is going to be what we say it is now, and it's not going to, there's going to be some sort of massive transformation or whatever. It's going to be what Hitler says it's going to be right now and forever. In the wake of the Enabling Act, in the wake of the Reichstag fire legislation, they started their arresting large numbers of people, and they started setting up camps. Dachau was the first, and then Oranienburg, several others, Sachsenhausen, to put people in. And the camps were run by a special segment of the SS called the Totenkopfverbände, the Death's Head. Death's Head units. You can also, by the way, just this is a piece of minutia, but you might find it interesting for those, many of you probably know it. You can always tell SS people because they wear black uniforms as opposed to the field gray of the German army, and because they have on their caps the Death's Head logo, like centrally, all of them, not just the Death's Head, the Totenkopfverbände. The Totenkopfverbände were the people who ran the concentration camps. And originally, they were sort of seen as a kind of re-education experience because most of the people who were in them were political opponents of the regime in the period between 33 and about 36. There's a really great book, and I cannot remember the guy's name who wrote it. It's called Fatherland. Anybody who wants to know, you can stop by the reference desk and I'll recall it then. But he was a communist, and he was sent to one of the ones in Berlin, and then I think to Dachau. But what he said was, in this book he wrote about it afterwards, for the middle class people who were there, it was a really terrifying experience, right? Because they didn't understand what was happening to them. They were used to sort of, you know, kind of order where there's rules and you obey the rules. And but for the communists, it made a kind of sense, right? Because they had been, for a long time, the communists were illegal anyway. So they had a sort of analysis of what National Socialism was. It was wrong, but they had a story that explained it, right? So they knew why they were there. And they knew what the fight, I mean, they were not wrong about the fight they were engaged in. And so the one of the sort of peculiarities of the camp system is that the Communist Party comrades would always look out for each other. This was a sort of a source of real annoyance, especially in Auschwitz, where Communist Party people. So there were a certain number of like prisoner kind of like administrators and prisoner workers that had got to work in the camps. And if you were a Communist Party comrade and you got into one of these positions, it was your duty, and you would be told as much by the people running the show, by the communist hierarchy within the camp, that your first priority was going to be looking after party comrades, and then if you could help some other people after that too, that was super, but you were there to look after the party comrades first. By about 1936, 35-36, they start clearing the camps out of these people, and they reload them with criminals, asocials, which means just any weirdo, I mean anybody who seemed to not fit in, and the work shy, i.e. people who are unemployed. It wasn't until 1938 that they start putting lots of Jews in the camps, and in fact, like the Jewish population of the camps that were in Germany, and so the major ones being Dachau, Buchenwald, Sachsenhausen, Salzgitter, Dora, Mittelbau, Ravensbrück, which is the big women's camp. A lot of the Jews who were there were people who were too well known to kill. So for instance, they had Leon Blum, who had been the premier of France. When they invaded France, they arrested him and they stuck him in Dachau in Buchenwald for the duration mostly. The real murdering happened. Now, this is not to say that murdering didn't happen in those places. But I mean, I should have written this down. But the number of victims of Buchenwald is something on the order of 45 or 50,000. people died, which is a lot of people, right? But it's not Treblinka where 750,000 people died, or Auschwitz where probably over a million, although these numbers are just guessing. I mean, we're not just guessing, I shouldn't say, but it's hard to be precise. So there's this kind of threefold development process in the camps where they start out with the political prisoners, then they move to the people who don't fit in. Now they want to get those people out of the country, out of the camps by 1938, and the reason is because by that time the German economy is booming so much that they're really short of labor. So basically anybody who's able-bodied, they don't want you, and not Jewish. And this is another interesting thing about National Socialism. They're sort of, we tend to think like, well, if you've got a kind of economic motivation, that's going to sort of blot out all your other dumber ideas. Like, so if you need to get this work done, it's going to disincline you to kill off the people who might do it for you. But as it turned out, the anti-Semitic motivation was such that it happened in numerous cases in Poland and in Russia after the invasion of Poland in 1939, the invasion of Russia in 1941, that the SS would come in and kill the entire Jewish population. So there's a famous letter that the local commander, and I forget, this was somewhere in Russia, wrote to the higher-ups. He said, we have all this work that needs to be done, and we had these specialist craftsmen, Jewish craftsmen. The rest of their families had already been killed. We needed this work done, and then in comes the Einsatzgruppe of people and shot them all. And now you're really putting us behind schedule. Now, note that the problem that this person had was not that they murdered all of these men, women, and children, but that it had discommoded him in terms of getting his wagons fixed or whatever. So it's common to think that the Nazis came to power and then all of a sudden like bad things started happening to the Jews, which is not entirely untrue. The SA, one of the things they were very fond of doing was just beating up Jews in the street. Jews in Germany were numbered about 500,000 at this time, between 0.5% and 1% of the German population. They were heavily concentrated in Berlin and Frankfurt. They were probably slightly overrepresented in finance and in the professions. But part of that has to do with the legal strictures that they were under prior to that. I mean, for centuries, Jews had been forbidden to enter certain professions, so they entered other ones that they were allowed to be in. But the fact of the matter is, there were a lot of Jewish workers. I mean, there were a lot of the Jewish working class was very prominent. Also, the Jews, I've mentioned this at other times for those of you who've been here, were the Jews of Germany were the most thoroughly assimilated Jewish community in all of Europe. And if you'd asked a European in 1900 where they thought mass violence against the Jews was going to break out, Germany would not have been anywhere near the top of the list. It would have probably been Russia, where the Black Hundreds, conducted pogroms and murdered Jews in large numbers, or in France, where the Dreyfus Affair had started up serious anti-Semitic feeling throughout the country, or had made it plain. Intermarriage was so common between German Jews and non-Jewish Germans that the Jewish community in Berlin got kind of worried that Jews were kind of going to disappear as a group because so many of them were marrying outside of the community. And that's just a sign that that Jews were a part of an integral part of German life. There was anti-Semitism. There was anti-Semitism in every European country. So anti-Semitism in the United States. I mean, it used to be the case that because of the way that Mr. Ford thought about the world, that when you bought a Model T, you got a free copy of the Protocols of the Elders of Zion to go with it. So the Germans had no corner on the market on anti-Semitism, but the Jewish community in Germany was very tightly integrated into German life. And it took the Nazis a while to dissimilate them. A lot of the Jews, I mean, the vast majority of them were highly paid. I mean, there was Jewish communists like there were German communists. But a lot of them were, a lot of Jews were highly patriotic. And a lot of them had fought, there's a fellow named Victor Klemperer, who was a professor at the Technical University of Dresden. He was Jewish and had fought as a front soldier in the First World War. And at one point, he kept these diaries throughout the entire time. He was not deported, and the reason was because he had a non-Jewish wife. If you were married to a non-Jew, they wouldn't deport you. The minute she died, they would deport you. But also it meant that they had to live in the special sort of Jewish house, and they both got their ration cards, had a big red J stamped on them, which meant that they got deficient food. And anyway, he kept a diary the entire time. I really recommend it. There's two volumes of it. It's really compelling, and it gives you a sort of worm's eye view of what things were like. It was also an act of real bravery, because if they had found, he kept getting, you've been living in the Jews' house, like, they would periodically get visited by this team of Gestapo guys, these two guys who they nicknamed Hitter and Spitter. You can kind of tell what sort of people they were. But keeping a diary was explicitly illegal for him, because he wasn't allowed to own paper or a typewriter. And so if they'd have found him, he would have been executed if he would have found the diary. As a matter of fact, one of the reasons it wasn't was because he had this Catholic housemaid, and she took like bits of the diary away and hid it. Eventually, just to finish his story, he and his wife were in Dresden, and they were going to be sent to a concentration camp. This was in 1944. And the night before it happened, the U.S. Air Force, U.S. Army Air Corps, basically bombed Dresden out of existence. And in the chaos, they just ripped the stars off and ran off into the night and pretended, you know, we're just Germans from somewhere else. Which they could do. Why? Because there's no difference between Germans and Jews. I mean, there was this idea that the Nazis like to sort of put around. It's just, you know, the Jews have this like thing that you can tell. There's a sort of medieval idea that Jews have a certain smell, which is also not true. But the fact of the matter is, it was perfectly easy for them. Things were kind of chaotic in Germany at that time, to just tear the stars off their clothes and go about, because there was no difference between them and any other German. There was no way of proving that there wasn't. So yeah, Nazi anti-Semitism. It builds on this anti-Semitism that's present throughout Europe. But it understands race in terms of blood. And that's horrifically dangerous. I mean, racism is a bad enough thing. Racism is a ridiculous idea, generally. I mean, the fact of the matter is, it's so unscientific that it's just, there's no point in discussing it. But the idea that there's some sort of like genetic basis for it is a complete fantasy. But it's an extremely dangerous idea, because if I look at people and I think to myself, like, you know, that person or that person, it's their blood that makes them do this bad thing. It's their blood that makes them dangerous. Then a little baby is just as dangerous as a grown person. And plenty of those got shot or gassed. So this is, you know, I try to be careful about the idea of taking lessons from history. And the fact of the matter is, if the lesson you're looking for is don't kill people, that's one you shouldn't need history for. But the lesson about this is really that if when you start to sort of like trying to delineate who's really human and who isn't, who gets full human consideration and who doesn't, that is a slippery slope to an extremely bad place. The Nazis started with a series of anti-Semitic measures. They staged a boycott in 1933. You weren't supposed to go to Jewish-owned businesses. This mostly annoyed people. And the reason is, number one, you're a German housewife. You got to go shopping once and probably twice a day, because you haven't got a refrigerator, by and large. So everything you go, you got to go to the baker, and you got to go to the store for food, and anything else you need, you probably got to go to. So if you're a German housewife, you don't want to walk extra blocks with all this stuff, right? Forget that. So after a couple of days, Goebbels sends a note to Hitler. He says, I think we're just really annoying people, so why don't we just lay off of this thing? I have my piece of paper here, which reminds me. The April laws, 1933, the central one was the law for the regeneration of the German civil service, which basically meant getting rid of all the Jews and politically unreliable people out of the civil service. The civil service included all university professors. University professors were civil servants in Germany. People who had been front soldiers in the First World War were excluded. That is to say, not just you'd been a soldier, but you'd served at the front. So if you were a clerk at the supply depot back behind, that didn't cut it. And people would have to go in and prove that they had been, that they had done frontline service. There's a German philosopher named Karl Löwit who was Jewish and who was had been a front soldier. And he was talking to a friend of his when this came down, a non-Jewish friend, and the guy said to him, well, why are you so upset about it? You're not going to lose your position. You were a front soldier. And Löwit said, and I think this is a really powerful response, why should I purchase with my service what's my right as a human being? And I think that's, you know, he eventually ended up going to Turkey, I think. In 1935, the Nuremberg Laws basically stripped Jews of their German citizenship. And that's a very dangerous thing to do to somebody, because if you no longer have the protection of a state in this world, you are in a bad place. Interestingly, there's a fellow named Hans Globke who was a Nazi lawyer who ended up, when laws are promulgated in Germany, like they'll have lawyers sort of write commentaries about what they mean, and Globke wrote the sort of interpretive commentaries on the Nuremberg Laws, and they ended up serving in Adenauer's government after the war, and a lot of social democrats were like, Why couldn't you find somebody else besides Hans Globke? Like, Nazism is over now, we thought, but. 1936, they start for real terms, the Aryanization of the economy, which this is mostly seizure of Jewish businesses and forcible sale of those businesses, usually for a pittance to Aryan owners. Once again, I say this every time, but it bears repeating, Aryan is not a scientific term in the way that the Nazis used it. Aryans are an ethnic group in northern India that have absolutely nothing to do with some sort of European master race. So when I say Aryan, I'm using scare quotes because it's not a real thing. I just mean that I'm just using a kind of shorthand, a sort of Nazi shorthand, unfortunately, for referring to Germans who weren't Jewish. Now, what we see is a sort of process of ramping up, and there's a kind of, people say, well, why didn't the Jews saw that things were not going to a very good place, why didn't they all leave, right? But there's a lot of problems with that. I mean, number one, raise your hand here if you speak a foreign language fluently. Yeah, not that many of you. So imagine trying to go to some other country and get a job. Even if they'd let you in, which in a lot of cases they wouldn't. Also, there's a book called The Twisted Road to Auschwitz that makes the point that Jews got sort of mixed messages. So sometimes they could sort of let themselves believe, this won't get that bad. These people, they say a lot, but maybe this is the sort of extent of it, right? And in fact, in 1936, there was a sort of let up. And can anyone want to guess why that was? The Olympic Games, right. They didn't want to have a bunch of foreign reporters coming in and getting a bunch of atrocity stories that were going to go out to the foreign press. So they kind of laid low. They sort of pulled back a little bit. And a lot of Jewish people thought, well, it'll be all right. It'll be bad, but Jews have a long history of riding out bad times for 2,000 years in Europe. What eventually happened was that a lot of younger Jews emigrated with the idea that they would get sorted out And then they would bring over their parents and their grandparents. With the result that, I mean, it was hard to emigrate too because after 1936, you weren't allowed to take your money or position. You could take a small amount of money, but not much. With the result that a couple of generations of German Jews were wiped out almost completely because they were caught in Germany when the real deportation started in 1939, 1940. This is a sort of card that they put out when they passed the Nuremberg laws to sort of let you know if you were a Jew or not. Everybody had to go to a sort of office and prove like whether they were a Jew or not. So if you have four Jewish grandparents, you're a Jew. If you have three Jewish grandparents, you're a Jew. If you have two Jewish grandparents, you're a Mischling of the first grade, a Mixling. If you have one Jewish grandparent, you're a second grade Mixling, and then of course if you don't, you're German blooded. They have a, God, they love this kind of stuff. I mean, it's it has no relation to things in actual, the real world. The interesting thing was too that there were a fair number of people who got down to the office and found out, much to their surprise, that they were actually Jews. And, but the, you know, what you believe about yourself, you know, you could be like 50 years old and have never even spoken the word Jew, much less had any experience with it. But depending on who your grandparents were, you were a Jew. And then you were an enemy of Germany. Yeah, this is another one of their crazy, they like to put out, I mean, there's tons of literature like this. Yeah, it's important that you make the correct choice of a marriage partner. Because you're going to produce a lot of offspring. So what you want is a good in your choice lies the fate of I can't read that, but it's of your race, of your Geschlecht, of your species and the nation. This is a public spaces became parsed. So this is a picture from 1938. You can see nur für Juden, only for Jews. And of course, this woman doesn't want to be photographed for reasons that don't need explaining. This is another completely bizarre thing. This is a placard from Munich, 1937. Vorsicht, Judenmord, caution. Or, yeah, caution Jews in the locality. Like, oh my God. The sort of anti-Jewish, the sort of fixation with Jewish blood was part of their whole program about eugenics. They were fascinated with the idea of like cutting away the deficiently, the genetically deficient part of the population. Starting in 1933, they passed a law mandating compulsory sterilization of people with schizophrenia, epilepsy, imbecility, which is, covers a lot of things, Huntington's chorea. They instituted hereditary health courts where you could be brought if you had a sort of disabled offspring and possibly be forcibly sterilized. Exceptions were made to this after 1937, and the reason was they were so short of labor at that point that anybody who was even close to able-bodied, they would give a pass to. Sterilization, not a punishment, but deliverance. What parent would want such an appalling lot for their children? Who wants to be responsible for this? The danger of the more vigorous increase of the deficient, I mean, this is a weird thing. Okay, if Aryans are so great, how come it's the case that they're constantly being destroyed by the deficient? So, like, this good German married couple, they make two, and then they make two more, and then they make two more. But the horrible people, they just make tons and tons and tons of babies they keep breeding. Soon we'll be swamped in them. This is the, one of the creepier ones. We do not stand alone. The law for the prevention of genetically deficient progeny. And basically what they're doing is pointing out the countries that also have laws mandating forcible sterilization. And you'll notice that we are right on the top of the list, because in 1929, 36 U.S. states had laws mandating forcible sterilization. Some of you remember 1927 Buck versus Bell decision. Carrie Buck was a woman who her mother was disabled somehow. She had a child when she was 18, and she was sort of supposedly a prostitute, which was not true. She had actually been raped by her cousin and then put into a home because her family wanted to spare themselves the humiliation of their unmarried 18-year-old daughter being pregnant. And the people running the place wanted to have her sterilized, and she fought it, went to the Supreme Court, and they ruled against her, and Justice Holmes wrote in the decision, two generations of imbeciles is enough. And apparently, number one, apparently Carrie Buck was an avid reader. She was to the end of her life. And her daughter actually did quite well in school. But the Nazis explicitly, as a matter of fact, they studied the eugenics laws in the United States to model their own. Once again, I know I harp on this, but let's just be clear. When you start deciding who's a full-fledged member of the human race, who gets the rights and dignities of being a human being, you've gone down a road you really don't want to get to the end of. This congenitally ill person will cost the racial community 60,000 Reichsmarks in the course of his life. Racial comrade, that's your money. Read New Race, the Journal of the Racial Political Office of the NSDAP, where you can find lots of kooky ideas about how we can prevent this. 1939, they start something called the T4 program. It was headquartered at Tiergarten 4, number 4 Tiergarten in Berlin. And it was meant to address the problem of the disabled by killing them. Because they were viewed as useless mouths, useless eaters. Between September 1939 and August 1941, they killed about 70,000 people. They would be sort of, an administrator would come and send them to they had these sort of like facilities that were generally kind of out in the boonies. The killings were usually done with an injection of phenol to the heart, or by gassing with carbon monoxide. And this was the origin. Actually, the people who worked on the T4 program were then brought in as consultants when they started mass gassing of Jews in 1940, or August 1941, Clemens von Galen, who was a Catholic bishop, found out about what was going on and started giving sermons, basically calling out what was going on. They eventually put him in jail for this, but they had to stop the program too. Once again, the Nazis had this weird problem with bad publicity. But they didn't stop the program. And it was actually running. There's a case that's noted in the Robert Proctor's book about Nazi doctors, where the U.S. troops got to a psychiatric hospital and found that they had like killed the last of the patients 2 days previously or something like that, and they eventually ended up killing about 200,000 people. These are the two main guys doing it: Bühler and Brandt. Brandt was Hitler's personal doctor. That's the sort of letter that Hitler sent them. Basically allowing them to grant a merciful death to people deemed unfit to live. It's probably not a huge amount of time to get into this. I just will say, so we were talking earlier about the Nazis and their weird sort of cultural thing. So Goebbels, who was the propaganda minister, was kind of a modernist. He had some sympathy for jazz and for like modern classical music. Hans Rosenberg, who wrote the Myth of the 20th Century, which is this sort of like Nazi philosophy book. Goebbels described it as an intellectual burp. So they were constantly sort of like at odds. Hans Rosenberg wanted like, you know, people dancing around in lederhosen and, you know, Tyrolean Kleinberger hats, and Goebbels didn't, you know, Goebbels, who was the propaganda minister, would tell people, his people running the radio stations, don't be boring. We can't have like barefaced, stupid propaganda. We have to have propaganda that's going to interest people. Interestingly, given that I've just talked about the killing of the infirm, Goebbels had a club foot. This is a theory about Nazi bureaucracy. I don't know why that turned yellow, but so we sort of think of, we like to think of like the Nazis as Hitler and then a sort of like fully worked out set of bureaucratic organizations. But in fact, this is what Nazi Germany worked like. So there was the SS, which had its finger in all the pies. And then there were a lot of other organizations sort of overlapping, whose capacities and responsibilities were not fully worked out. And the example I like to give, some of you have already heard this from me, is that the people who organized the transportation of Jews to the killing centers in Poland was not Deutsche Bahn, the railway service, although they were involved, but it was a group called Kraft durch Freude, which means strength through joy. And strength through joy in the pre-war period used to organize like hiking junkets and like holiday tours and stuff like that. And Hitler's management style was such that he liked to have his underlings sort of competing. He thought that that, you know, worked best. So rather than, Hitler mostly, although there's some exceptions to this, didn't like to micromanage things. He didn't want to involve himself in the minutia, unless it was architecture. He was he'd failed getting into architecture school and he never got over it. So like the guy, the architect they brought in to kind of reconfigure Berlin, Hitler would have these hours-long meetings with the guy where they would talk about every pillar that they were gonna, whatever. Mostly Hitler didn't want to be bothered with the day-to-day business of getting things done. So he would sort of let it be known that he wanted certain kinds of things done. And then his sort of underlings would kind of compete to see who could get it done, given the resources that they had. And this is important. So for a long time, when we looked at Nazism, the histories of Nazism that happened in the late 40s and the 50s and early 60s were very much about what Hitler and his associates did and what they thought and what they wanted. And this mode of history this historical school is sometimes referred to in the debates that happen later as intentionalism. And it's because the central feature of National Socialism is the intention of Hitler and the people around him. Hitler hated Jews, therefore we get the Holocaust. You know, Hitler wanted to conquer Europe, therefore we get Nazi imperialism. And it's not to say, let's be clear, Hitler did hate Jews, there's no two ways about that. But then, in the 1960s, a historian named Martin Brojat came along and basically rejigged our understanding of the Nazi state to one commensurate with that one that I just showed you. That it wasn't a sort of like fully worked out bureaucracy where Hitler would say, let X happen, and then there would be a sort of orderly process of his will spreading out. That what there was a sort of competing process of various people within the German bureaucracies undertaking something that came to be called working toward the Führer. So the Führer isn't going to give us precise instructions about what to do. What we're going to do is he's going to give sort of general ideas. And then we're going to try and interpret those and make them real given the resources that we have. And the reason that this is important is because this is a, okay, so people looked at this and were like, well, the benefit, the sort of good thing about the earlier way of looking at it is you really knew who was guilty of what. You want to know who's guilty? It's Hitler. And this doesn't absolve him, but this doesn't absolve him of guilt. The sort of this later way of looking at it, which is sometimes called structuralism or sometimes called functionalism. But the reason why this is a powerful way of understanding it, this is the German version of the book and this is the English one, it's hard to find now. They need to come out with a new edition. You can get it through Ohio Link, and I really recommend it if you're really interested in the way Nazism actually worked. The reason it's important is because it lets you know how things got so intensified. Like, it used to be the process that was sort of looked at as like, well, Hitler had these bad ideas and then he sort of eventually put them into power, put them into practice. But what we see actually happen in the Nazi government is that, and this is particularly true about the Holocaust. The Holocaust really happened mostly in 1942 and 43. About 75% of the people who got killed in the Holocaust got killed between the late spring of 42 and the winter of 43. And what you see is this spasm of intense violence that's being brought around by the intensity being ramped up, partly by the war. I mean, what's happening in this period too, like the things are going badly wrong on the Russian front. As a matter of fact, there's a guy named Arno, a historian Arno Meyer, wrote a book called Why Did the Heavens Not Darken, in which he basically said that the Stalingrad basically was the reason for the mass killing, the spasm of mass killing. It's not, I think he's wrong about that. But it's an interesting idea, and it gets at something which is really true, which is that the war and things going badly on the Russian front really intensified the killing process. All right, so why am I telling you these things about National Socialism in power? And why is this a lecture, why do I call this a lecture on National Socialism in power? A lot of times, if you're going to hear a lecture like this, it's going to be a lot of pictures of, you know, the Nazi Party rally, and a list of, you know, then this happened, then this happened. But the thing I want to get to as the sort of central issue of National Socialism in power is that it's a process that happens. It wasn't like January 30, 1933 happens, and then all of a sudden we get a sort of predictable process of things happening after that, right? What it is a sort of complex process in which, first of all, a lot of the German population had to be kind of brought around to the more extreme measures. And then starting in 1939, you get the war with the invasion of Poland. And all of a sudden, Germany is now in control of this large body of people. Like, they have this, there's this sort of idea that the Germans need Lebensraum, the Germans need space to live. And the way they're going to get it is by enslaving the Slavic peoples to the east and repopulating those lands with ethnic Germans. And so, what I'm trying to convey to you here, what I've tried to convey, is that National Socialism in power was a process of ramping up. It wasn't a straight journey from A to B. It was a complex process in which people who lived it didn't really see it as a kind of linear experience. But what you get across the sort of scope of Nazism is a process of dissimilating people from the Volksgemeinschaft, from the racial community. People who are disabled, people who are Jews, people who have different political views. I mean, there's a kind of interesting conflation that goes on between people who are politically dissenting and people who are not fully human. And so we end up with this war that goes on starting in 1939 and ends in catastrophic defeat in 1945, which is a war for race and space fought out across Europe and about half of the sort of Eurasian landmass. in which the Nazis try and realize this idea that they've tried to put into practice in Germany of a purified racial state. They try and sort of telescope it into the real world outside of Nazi Germany. And from these ideas that start out small in Germany, what you get is a really incredible process of mass killing. Now, once again, I said at the beginning, Stalin killed a lot more people than Hitler did. Stalin had a lot more time to do it. Stalin gets into power end of the 20s and is in power until he dies in the early 50s. Hitler's really only in power, I mean, he's only in power for 12 years. But the real serious killing only happens in the space of about 3 years, 4 years. And that's the thing to really remember about if you want to think about Nazism in power. What it is a process of deciding who fits. And eventually that process of deciding who fits becomes a process of who gets to live.